Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this service this morning on this very wet and wild and windy day. And we especially welcome all those that have stayed at home and watching via live stream. Welcome. Today's retiring offering goes to the Burb Network to help their work with the Murjim children in the Kimberley. And next week, the tea roster is vacant, so if anyone can help, that would be wonderful. If not, I'm afraid there'll be no morning tea next week. Thank you. Welcome back to Ian and Audrey. We haven't seen you for a few weeks, so it's lovely to have you here with us again. Thanks.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." Let us pray. O God, we often come like that crowd on the hillside by the lake. We come needing your care, your compassion. Come full of concerns, worries, uncertainties, knowing that you look upon us as your people, as the sheep of your pasture. Enable us, we pray, to look at one another with the eyes of compassion and love, that we in your presence may be renewed and filled with a spirit of care which we are able to share in our lives, in our families, in our workplaces, and in our communities. Come to us, we pray, Good Shepherd. Feed us with the bread of life, and fill us with your Spirit, that we may never thirst. In your own name we pray, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
I have a lot of people sitting on my shelves. One of them is the Mullah Nasruddin. Do you know the Mullah Nasruddin? Have you heard of him? Many stories about him. One of my favorite stories about the Mullah Nasruddin is that they find him one day sitting at the prominent crossroads in the village. And he's sitting there very intently looking. And people say, "Why are you here?" And he says, "The day will come when something really important happens here, and there will be a great crowd, and I won't be able to see. So I've come early to get the best spot so that I can say, I was sitting at the crossroads looking." What I like about that parable, which comes from the Muslim tradition, the Sufi branch, is that it invites us to take the way we look at things and just turn the kaleidoscope slightly so that we find new perspectives. And in a way, that's what happens in this season when we read different parts of the story of David and we see different facets of the person. And in these weeks in particular, when we read the Gospel of John and the account of the reflections and experiences following the feeding of the 5,000. So if something weird happens today, just turn the kaleidoscope. You might find something new.
As we hear the ancient stories, open our hearts and minds to hear your message, O God. The first reading continues from 2 Samuel chapter 11. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. When the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. He brought it up, and it grew up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his meagre fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveller to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him." Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judea. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this very sun. For you did it secretly. But I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Nathan said to David, Now the Lord has put away your sin, you shall not die.
Psalm 51 is given the title, A Psalm of David, when the prophet came to him after he had gone to Bathsheba. Let us borrow from the psalmist's words written for David. Have mercy on me, gracious one, out of your abundant kindness, forgive me where my thoughts and actions have hurt others. Allow me to hear what is hard to hear and see what is hard to see, so that I may know who I really am, and when I keep myself from your love, or live in ways which cause others pain. Too often I hide myself or cover up my weaknesses, and at times deny who I am. Yet you have made me your own, and love is your constant gift. You have placed your truth in me. Teach me your ways. Forgive me when I live in fear. Fill my mind and heart so that I might radiate love. Renew me that your light might shine in me. Fill me with gladness. Help me to learn from you. Free me from bondage to my past mistakes, and empower me to fill my mind with desires which honor my call to live as your child. Create in me a clean heart, O gracious one, and put a new and right spirit within me. Enfold me in the arms of love and fill me with your Holy Spirit. O most gracious and compassionate friend, melt our hearts of stone. Break through all that keeps us from you and apart from one another, and guide us in the way of peace so that we may share your grace and love.
The Gospel reading this morning is from John 6. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we might see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Speak to us now, we pray, O God, that we might be nourished in faith."
Amen.
In a barn near Bethlehem, passed by many a wandering stranger, the most precious word of life was heard gurgling in a manger for the good of us all. And he's here when we call him, bringing health, love, and laughter to life now and ever after for the good of us all. By the Galilean lake, where the people flocked for teaching, the most precious word of life fed their mouths as well as preaching for the good of us all. And he's here when we call him, bringing health, love, and laughter to life now and ever after for the good of us all. Quiet was Gethsemane, and a frightening priest and soldier, the most precious word of life took the world's weight on his shoulder.
Milton Erickson was trained in both psychology and psychiatry, and he was known to be a little unconventional. Sometimes that meant he was given hard cases. He was asked to visit a doctor's aunt, and the visit was arranged. The aunt was single again after the death of her husband. She had no children of her own. She had largely cut herself off from people and rarely left the house. She had a Christian faith and had been a very active member of the church, but she rarely went anymore. And when she did, she discouraged people from talking with her. She was clearly suffering from a deep clinical depression. When Erickson arrived, he found a darkened house, blinds drawn, and little light. He spent time talking with her, then he demanded a tour of the house. She was a little taken aback, but being polite, she complied, and she took him around the dark, blind-drawn house. Until, surprisingly, they came to one room that was filled with sunlight. This was the room where she kept her African violets. They were flowering vigorously and radiating life. And she even had a pot where she had planted a leaf. And leaves in African violets simply grow into a new African violet. It was then that Erickson spoke. He said to the woman, "You are a bad Christian." She was taken aback and quite deeply upset. He said, "You have money, you have a house, you have time, you have a green thumb, and it's all going to waste. Being a doctor and having promised a prescription, he gave her a prescription. She should buy a lot of pots, fill them with potting mixture, and African violets of every color she could find. She should take the leaves and plant them in pots and propagate the violets. When a baby was born in the church or the neighborhood, when a newcomer moved to the district, when there was an engagement or someone got married, when a child was born or baptized, when a person lost a partner or a child, she was to give them an African violet." That was it. He never saw her again. Several decades later, when he was speaking to some students training in psychology, he pulled out a tattered newspaper headline which his doctor friend had sent him when she died. "African violet lady dies, mourned by thousands." One student asked him, "Why did you tell her to grow flowers and not use your professional skills and treat her depression?" He replied that in her house, the only sign of life were the violets, and he thought it would be easier to grow them than to weed out the depression. This is an example of taking an oblique approach. Economist John Kay has written about it in his book Obliquity. He describes an interesting range of things. People who directly pursue happiness rarely find it. And it's often only when they stop directly pursuing it and do something else, that they are happy. Companies that are in business solely for the purpose of making money are often not the most profitable. The most profitable are often the people with a product that they so believe in and think is good for the world, who are glad to make money, but it's not their primary reason for being, who are often the most successful. Now, this wouldn't have happened to you, but I find that when I've got a problem and I give it my full and direct attention insofar as I can, given that my brain jumps all over the place all the time, it takes longer to fix, and I often don't manage it. And it's often only when I set it aside, stop concentrating on it, and I come back, and the answer jumps out at me, and I think, why didn't I see this all the time? Now, this might have happened to you. You know, you're looking for something in the house, you've looked everywhere, you've looked twice, you've looked three times, and you can't find it. And then you see it, and it was there in plain sight all the time. Poet Emily Dickinson describes these phenomena when she writes, "Tell all the truth, but tell it slant. Truth often gets through indirectly." Her little poem goes on like this: "Tell all the truth, but tell it slant. Success in circuit lies, too bright for our infirm delight, the truth's superb surprise. As lightning to the children eased with explanation kind, the truth must dazzle gradually, or every man be blind." How often it is that in the house that is ourselves, we have darkened spaces where we do not turn on the lights and we draw the blinds and sometimes we shut the door. So that when we come to a sunlit room, it can be dazzling. Success in circuit lies. Confrontation often leads to resistance and anger. The indirect way is often the way that the truth will break through. David's plan to have Uriah killed and take his wife Bathsheba for himself came to pass. However, the theologian storytellers who wrote this warts and all account of David say this displeased the Lord. Something of an understatement, given that arguably he'd broken five of the Ten Commandments in one go. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or anything else of your neighbor's. So what did God do about that? God sent Nathan. Well, would you like to be Nathan? I often wonder how the prophet Nathan felt, and the biblical stories don't even enter into that. The king was the highest human power, the highest authority, the chief of the military, and Nathan had to go to the king. However, God gives Nathan a way, a story, a parable, and he goes with that story to David. It's not really a complicated case. The king, after all, would have heard these things quite often. He was the highest judge, and the royal court was the highest court. And David hears the story and sees immediately what is wrong and declares the sentence on that person. That man deserves to die. And then Nathan says, "You are the man." It's one thing to think about a hypothetical case. It's another when we realize it relates to us. David sees his fault and acknowledges it by saying, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan speaks the word of God, "The Lord has put away your sin." However, that forgiveness does not mean all is restored perfectly. There are still consequences for David of the actions he took. And Nathan speaks of the rest of his life, which will be lived in the shadow of trouble, of conflict, of mistrust. And the rest of David's story shows this. It can be frightening to turn to God. It can be freeing to turn to God. And it is always restoring to turn to God. We may not want to open the blinds on every part of our lives, and yet God will always see where the growth is happening. The areas in our lives where the gifts bloom, the possibilities and ways we can be a blessing to others. While God is with us in the dark and in the light, God calls us to take the gifts that are in our hands and to cultivate them for the sake of others, so that our lives might bear witness to the God who always gives new beginnings. Amen.
Thank you.
Gracious and loving God, you call us into relationship with you and with each other. Together we are your people here in this place at this time. Hold us together as we grow in our faith and serve others and our community. We pray for ourselves and for each other. We ask that you help us to learn humility, gentleness, and patience, so that we may support others in love. We thank you for our differences. May we recognize the gifts that others bring, as well as our own skills and abilities, so that together we build a sharing community that reflects your love. We pray that we might grow in your likeness, maturing in faith and embracing the gifts you have given us to serve others in love. We pray for our church here at Floreat, and especially for the elders and church councillors as we gather each week, that in our local community we recognise the needs and respond with action. We pray for churches everywhere, and this week, on Wednesday the 4th of August, is Aboriginal Children's Day. And we pray for the children of Mowanjim and around Australia, for their love, health, education, and future opportunities. And we remember St. Andrew's Perth Uniting Church and Uniting Church in the City, Uniting Network, and give thanks for generations of faithful servants who have proclaimed the gospel by word and deed, encouraging and building up the body of Christ. We pray for our world, for those who hunger and thirst, for those who are in lockdown, for those who live in despair. We pray for those who are ill or suffering or mourning. We pray for countries where faith and religious belief is not able to be freely expressed or has become a political tool. We pray for the country's leaders, that they may be tolerant, work to build up the whole community, and understand the unique gifts the vulnerable and isolated bring. We pray that as a wider community, we continue to act against injustice, to speak out against violence and lack of tolerance, to be hospitable to the lost and welcoming to the world. Jesus, we pray that we act in the unity to which you call us. Hear our prayers, gracious God. Hold us together in love and grace, and keep us working with you. We pray in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. O God, who lavishes gifts, who enables us to find opportunities to care and to serve, we dedicate ourselves in your service, and we pray that all that we do, all that we offer, and all that we are may be used in your service. In the name of Christ, Amen.
Thank you.
gift of bread, which will become for us the bread of life. We give thanks, O God, for the gift of wine, which will become for us the cup of salvation. The invitation to this table comes from the God who forgave David his great sin, from the Christ who welcomed all who would turn to him, from the Spirit who prompts us to respond and say yes to God. All are welcome, for this is the table of the Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you and praise you, O God, for your constant presence and creativity, for all the ways you have opened us to your truth, to the countless numbers of your people down the generations who have heard you speak, to all the ways you have allowed us to be dazzled gradually, so that we may look back on our lives and see your presence constantly, steadfastly with us. We bless you as we remember all those individuals who have shown us your face. And so we praise you with all of your faithful people of every time and place, joining with all who have gone before us and all the choirs of heaven, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We bless you, O God, as we remember Jesus who came in your name. His ministry of compassion and care, his teaching, his gathering of frail and ordinary people like us, calling them to great things in the service of God, his willingness to endure anguish and rejection and physical suffering, even to death on the cross, his words of forgiveness to those who put him there, and for the wondrous message on the third day that he had risen from the dead. And so, in remembrance of Jesus, we offer ourselves as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We remember too, O God, how at that last gathering for supper with the disciples, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and shared it with them, saying, This is my body given for you. And after supper, the cup. Again he gave thanks and he shared it with them, saying, This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. So send your Spirit, we pray, O wondrous creative God, upon all of us and upon the gifts that we shall share, that we may truly share in the communion of the body and blood of Christ, and we may live in him, and he may live in us forevermore. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup we take is a sharing in the blood of Christ. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Under our COVID plan, we serve some people from the front and some from behind. You will know if you're being served from behind if you have the empty row behind you. So we invite you, just as you are able, to turn and receive as the elders bring the bread and later the cup to you. And it is our custom here for us to hold the bread and for all of us to eat, and later to hold the cup and for all of us to drink together. the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Let us pray. Most loving God, in Christ you feed us and satisfy our thirst. We bless you for the ways in which you connect us with your people of this and every place, of ours and every time. And we pray that the communion we share may be a glimpse of the glory which will be ours in your light forever. In the name of Christ, amen. A paraphrase of Paul's words at the beginning of Ephesians 4. I don't want people going on a path to nowhere. I want us, with humility and discipline, to pour out ourselves in acts of love, alert at noticing differences and, where possible, mending fences. We are all called to travel on the same road and in the same direction. So stay together. You have one master, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who rules over all, works through all, and is present in all. But that doesn't mean that you should all look and speak and be the same. Out of the generosity of Christ, each of us is given our own gifts. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with the fullness of God. Go now in peace, and the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Did that?
Oh, good.
I don't know, maybe I did it. I don't know how it happened. I don't even know.